out calls, blinded eyes to open, or the lame to walk again. But I know a man who can.
Titled Six Prayers That Can Change Your Life. And the first prayer that we looked at is, Lord, save me. We need to ask him to enter our hearts. Peter was praying. He was sinking there. And we used it as an analogy to tell you about salvation. That's the first prayer that we need to pray. It's a dangerous prayer to say, I need salvation. I'm asking for forgiveness for my sins. But then last week, we preached a message, Lord, search me, from David's psalm there, Psalm 139, that he asked God to search his heart. And that's something that we all need to do. And I pray that if you've not was not here to hear it, that you can go to the website, and the sermon is there for you to hear the things that God laid upon my heart. But this morning, we're going to preach from Luke chapter 22, verses 39 through 43, and we're going to look at a prayer that we've entitled, Lord, Subdue Me. Sometimes our plans want to get ahead of God, don't we? We want to do our own thing. And this is a prayer that we need to pray, that Lord, search me and subdue me. Then in the future, if the Lord should tarry his coming, we're going to look at Lord, stretch me, Lord, shape me, and Lord, solicit me. You know, it's exciting. And I get excited when we get to come to God's house. I said Wednesday night that we don't have to come, but we get to come. And it's a joy to be able to come to God's house. And I get excited when I'm here. I get excited about being in God's Word and preaching God's Word and hearing Him speak to us. I get excited about talking about Jesus. And I just get excited about what God's doing, what He's done in the past, and what He's going to do in the future. And I hope that you share in that excitement with me. But this morning, we want to read from Luke chapter 22, and we begin here in verse 39. And he came out, and went as it was wont, to the Mount of Olives, and his disciples also followed him. And when he was at the place, he said unto them, Pray that you enter not into temptation. And he was withdrawn from them about a stone's cast, and kneeled down and prayed, saying, Father, if thou be willing, remove this cup from me, nevertheless, not my will, but thine be done. And there appeared an angel unto him from heaven, strengthening him. May God add a blessing to the reading of his word. May we have ears to hear, eyes to see, and a heart that's receptive to his word this morning. Six prayers that can change your life. This is the third in the series that we've already went over this morning. Lord, save me. Lord, search me. Lord, subdue me. And we kind of got a jump verse that we kind of jump from, but in Matthew chapter 7, verses 7 and 8, the Bible says, Ask, and it will be given unto you. Seek, and you will find. Knock, and it will be opened. For everyone who asks receives, and he who seeks finds, and to him who knocks, it will be opened. You know, prayer is an important part of our Christian walk. It's that important part that we need. It's the part of our walk that keeps us in close fellowship to God. It's the way that we can know His will. It's a way that we can confess our sins. It's a way that we can petition our desires. It's a way that we can praise our Creator and worship the God of the universe. It is also one of the spiritual armors that Paul talks about in Ephesians. In Ephesians chapter 6, verse 12, he says that we have some enemies that we're facing. He says we need an armor, and he tells us about that. But he says, we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. And then in verse 18, he says, praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit. He says it's a spiritual armor that we have. You know, we as Christians know the power of prayer. And in James chapter 5, verse 16, the Bible says, The effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. What does that avail mean? It means that it has power. It has strength. It has a purpose. And we pray with a purpose that God would answer our prayers. But you know, Satan also knows the power of prayer. And he tries with all his might to keep us from praying. He does not want us to pray the sinner's prayer, asking Jesus to save us and asking him into our heart. Nor does he want us to pray a prayer, any prayer, after we become a child of God. He makes it so difficult for us to put prayer into our lives and to pray and to remember to pray. He does not want us to pray the prayer that we preached about last week where David said, Lord, search me. But prayer is important. Great evangelist Samuel Chadwick says, The one concern of the devil is to keep Christians from praying. He fears nothing from prayerless studies, prayerless work, prayerless religion. He laughs at our toil. He mocks at our wisdom, but he trembles when we pray. He knows the power of prayer. And everything that we do must begin with prayer. If we want to be a church that God blesses and uses, we must pray. If we want to be the child of God that pleases God and he can use for his glory, we must pray. Someone has said, a day without prayer is a day without blessing. And a life without prayer is a life without power. You look at your life and you wonder why you seem to be powerless. Look at your prayer life. Is it where it needs to be? Many times, though, we pray self-serving and we pray safe prayers and shallow prayers. But in order to grow, we need to pray dangerous prayers. And that's what this series is about, praying dangerous prayers. And you might ask the question, what is a dangerous prayer? A dangerous prayer is a prayer that puts our faith on the line and opens us up to God in a way that we've never opened up to Him before. It is a prayer that only God can answer and only God can do. It is something that is humanly impossible. And when it is answered, we see the divine. We see God's hand in the answer to that prayer. You know, Scripture is filled with believers and prayers of believers who wanted to mature and grow in their walk with God. And they were prayer warriors. It is filled with believers who prayed dangerous prayers. My friend, it is time for us to quit keeping God at a safe distance. It's time for us to quit putting God in a box and pray these dangerous prayers. And when we do, we will be amazed at what God will do in our life and in the life of this church. You know, Jesus is a great example of prayer. And we find in our text this morning that he prayed this prayer. The Bible reveals to us that he was accustomed to prayer. That's what the word means, he was wont, as he was wont, as he was accustomed. In fact, in another text, in another part of the New Testament, it says he was accustomed to pray. It was part of his everyday life. You know, as you look in the New Testament, you see that he prayed prayers of adoration. He prayed prayers of intercession. He prayed prayers of petition and thanksgiving. He prayed at his baptism. He prayed before selecting his apostles. He prayed at his transfiguration. He prayed in the Garden of Gethsemane. And he even prayed while he was upon the cross. You know, there are many events in this chapter that we look at in chapter 22. Jesus and his disciples had been involved in a very solemn observance, which we call the Lord's Supper. They were taking the Passover. And he was meeting with them and worshiping with them. And then he foretold that one would betray him. And then he said that one would deny him. But then in verse 39, it says he went out with his disciples. After Judas had left, the remaining disciples went out and followed Jesus. And he went to a place that he often went, and they knew what he was going there for. He was going to pray. It says he was accustomed to go to the Mount of Olives. The saving interest of a dying world and the eternal honor of his holy name come to focus in that garden. You see, humanity and divinity meet in the Garden of Gethsemane. And did you know that every time that we pray a dangerous prayer, that is what happens? Humanity, us, prays to a holy God. Divinity comes and intervenes and answers that prayer. Humanity and divinity meet every time that we pray a dangerous prayer. We find that in the Garden of Gethsemane, we find that he took and prayed that prayer. Now in the first garden, we find in the Garden of Eden, the first Adam fell through sin. But in another garden, the second Adam triumphed through suffering and prayer. And I want you to notice something from our text. And we see that in the first part of this chapter, they had been observing the Lord's Supper, but he knew that he was going to the cross. After we have been to the Lord's table, after we assemble together to fellowship, maybe the Lord's Supper, or maybe it's to worship and to hear God to speak to us through his word, after we have been to the Lord's table for fellowship, we have a work to do. Jesus had a work to do going to the cross. We have a work to do outside of these church walls of reaching people outside of here. It requires us, though, to be involved in private prayer. Because we have a ministry and because we have a work to do, because we want to honor the Lord, we need to be involved in private prayer. Since we have a work to do, there are two ways that we can do that work or that ministry. But there is only one that is successful. There is only one that brings blessings. We could do the ministry and work in our own strength and in our own abilities. Or we could pray and find the strength to do it in the power of the Holy Spirit. Because that's the way that blessings come. When we pray and we ask God to do something through us that we cannot do in and of ourselves. So Jesus teaches us a valuable lesson as he prayed the prayer, Lord, subdue me. And I want you to notice with me the three areas that we need to pray about when we pray this prayer. The outline is in your bulletin, on the back side of your bulletin, if you want to follow along with the outline. But first of all, we need to ask him to subdue my ego. Subdue my ego. In verse 42, we see he says, Father, if you be willing, remove this cup. Nevertheless, not my will. We know in verse 41 he had withdrawn to pray. He had withdrawn himself from others. Let me say this about that. Each person must approach the throne of grace individually. We have to get in our prayer closet. We have to get alone with God individually. Yes, it's okay that we ask people to pray for us. But there comes a time that we have to pray individually about the concern and the matters and the ministries that we're involved in. And in praying this prayer, Jesus shows us two things about our ego. You know, the ego is all about my will. And he said here, not my will. He was dealing with his pride. He was dealing with ego. Let me give you some examples here. The first point under this point number one is the example of a human ego. The Garden of Gethsemane was a place of solemn loneliness. We find that the Garden of Gethsemane teaches us that Jesus was humanity. He is divine and his humanity. He is the God-man. We must understand that. He was 100% human. He was 100% God. Only God could do that and bring the two together. But we find that he was humanity. And the prayer in that garden was dealing with his humanity. He withdrew himself far enough to be beyond any reach of help. I want you to get that picture. There's a lesson that we learn there. There was no help to him. His disciples couldn't help him. He told them to pray for him, but they couldn't help him in going to the cross and doing the ministry he was called to do. Others around him couldn't help him. The Jews, the religious people, no one could help him but the one that he turned to, and that's his heavenly Father. And he prayed to God. He said, Father. He was calling out to his Father. This is the place that we have to come to in our life. We must realize that our neighbors can't help us. Our family can't help us. We have to get alone with God and do business with him in our prayer life. And he will help us. You see, Jesus was getting ready to go to the cross. And the symbolism here is there was no one else could help him go to that cross but his Father. He had to be willing to go. It's the place that we have to come to in our life. You see, in Leviticus chapter 16, verses 29 and 30, on the great day of atonement, the high priest alone had to do the work of the ministry. The Bible says, and this shall be a statute forever unto you, that in the seventh month, on the tenth day of the month, you shall afflict your souls and do not work at all, whether it be one of your own country or a stranger that sojourneth among you. For on that day shall the priest make an atonement for you to cleanse you, that you may be clean from all sins, all your sins before the Lord. The high priest had to do that work on that day. Only he could do it. Jesus had to go to the cross, and only he could go for our sins. In the garden on that night before the great day of atonement on the cross, Jesus, our high priest, prayed alone for the work he was about to do. This was a prayer and a work that only Jesus could do. We must realize there's no other way to be saved other than Jesus. We sang the old hymn, Jesus paid it all. All to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, but he washed it white as snow. We sing another song that says, nothing in my hands I bring, simply to the cross I cling. We must cling to that old rugged cross and his amazing grace, because that's the only way of salvation. You and I may not be going to a cross, but there comes a point in our Christian walk that we must go to our own personal Garden of Gethsemane. We must go there to battle between our will and the will of the Father. We must go there because there is the battle between self and the Spirit. The reality is this. We are either living in the flesh or we are walking in the Spirit. And praying, Lord, subdue me, deals with this issue. Secondly, we see the example of a humble ego. The example of a humble ego. Notice Jesus prayed, not my will. You know, we live in a society that thinks of self first and puts self before others. It's the society of me, myself, and I. We live in a day that wants things their way. The McDonald's slogan, you deserve a break today. And Burger King, have it your way. But in order to be used and blessed by God, our pride has to be dealt with. Jesus is an example of one who had victory over pride and ego. But in contrast, Satan is an example of one who lost the battle. If you go over there in the Old Testament, you will read about Satan and his fall from heaven. And it says there that he said, I will lift up myself and be as God. I will do this and I will do that. That is pride speaking there. And he lost the battle. Anytime it's all about you and pride and me and I, you're losing the battle and you're not going to be used by God. Satan was cast out of heaven because of his pride. And one of the three temptations that Jesus faced when he began his ministry in Matthew chapter 4 deals with pride. Oh, surely if you fall off of here, all the people will follow you and a great crowd will flock to you. If you will do this and turn these stones into bread, everybody will say, look at him, let's follow him. It was about his pride. And he won that victory over pride at the beginning of his ministry and at the end of his ministry. And in order for us to be used of God, we must be broken of self. Yes, Christ knew the terrible contents of the cup. He knew about the holiness of God. But he also knew about the heinousness of sin. The only way that the cup could be dealt with was with the words, not my will, but thine be done. Many great saints in the Old Testament and the New Testament have been broken before they were used of God. We look at Moses, and Moses was going to save the nation of Israel, and he killed the Egyptian soldier who was hurting his brother. And God said, that's not the way it is. Your pride came out there, and you did it in anger and pride. And he put him in a mountain, on the backside of a mountain for 40 years to let him deal with that pride. And think about what he had done, and he broke him. And then he became a humble servant to lead the nation the way God wanted him to lead them. Jonah didn't like the people of Nineveh. And he said, I'm not going there to preach to them. And God said, okay, let's deal with your pride in the belly of a fish. And he put him there in the belly of the fish and the stinking filthiness of that fish. And he was ready to get out of there and go to Nineveh as soon as he did. But then we think about Peter. Peter said, I'll never deny you. I'm bold and I'm going to stand for you. And he was the one that denied. But we also see that Peter thought of the Jews more than he did the Gentiles. And God had to break him and say, salvation is for the Gentiles and the Jews. And he went to the home of Cornelius. And he broke that barrier down to reach other people. But then we look at Paul, whose name was Saul before it was changed. And we find that he had pride. He loved the Jewish religion. He loved the Jewish way and the vows that you take and the commandments and the laws. He loved all that. And he loved religion more than a relationship until on the road to Damascus, his pride brought him down to his knees and he was blinded because he saw what his pride was doing to him. And he came to know Jesus. Jesus did not have any pride. He had no sin. But why did he do this? Why did he pray this prayer? He did this because he said, my will is to always please the Father. He wanted to show us that pride will not please the Father. And he prayed this prayer to provide us an example of the victory over pride. He knew that we as humans are prideful. And in order to be all that God wants us to be, we need to deal with ourselves. But I want you to see that when we deal with ourselves and when we deal with our pride, what happens? Verse 42, an angel came and strengthened him. God will strengthen you in those times that you stand and you tear your pride away and you stand for him and do his will. David said in Psalm 138, verse 3, in the day when I cried, thou answerest me and strengthenest me with strength in my soul. You see, this angel teaches us the truth of humility. When we are humble and we deal with our pride, God will bless us. God will reward that and strengthen us. When we put our total dependence upon God, God will be there to provide for us. So Jesus resigned to God's will. And the question I asked us this morning, have we come to the place of humility where we have resigned to do God's will no matter what the cost, no matter what the circumstances, no matter what people say or what they think? That's what we have to do. We have to subdue our ego. Secondly, we need to pray that God would subdue my emotions. Think about Jesus and the emotions he was going through in the Garden of Gethsemane. The human emotions was there. You see, the Bible says here in verse 42 that he, not my will, but thine be done. He was agonizing. We must deal with our pride, but sometimes our passion gets in the way. The way we feel about something has to be dealt with. You see, it's not about our feelings. It's about what he desires. And sometimes our feelings get in the way. Notice the words, my will. This has to do with our passion. I want you to see two examples here. First of all, there's the example of a human emotion. The example of a human emotion. Jesus had all the human emotions that we have. He was hungry. He was thirsty. He grew weary. He got sleepy. He felt pain and he experienced humiliation. But he was also passionate about the things of God. He desired to do God's will. He was angry when people were disobedient and when they were cutting him down and saying things. He got upset. He had righteous indignation. In John chapter 3, he entered the temple and he became upset that they had turned his father's house of prayer into a house of merchandise. When he came in contact with the Pharisees who said they loved God but hated their neighbor and put all these demands upon them, it upset him to the point that he called them hypocrites and snakes. You see, he wanted to do God's will. In John chapter 4, verse 34, he said, my meat is to do the will of him that sent me and to finish his work. Dealing with his passion, his own plans had to be dealt with so he could go to the cross. If we could only be as passionate about the things of God as Jesus was, we would see a great revival in our community. Have you noticed that we as humans are passionate about so many things? Our family. And I love my family, and I know you love your family, but sometimes we are overly passionate about them and let them stand in the way of us serving and obeying God. We are passionate about our finances. We've got to make more money to have more money to have more stuff, and we're just so passionate about getting more and more. We're passionate about fitness. Gyms are full of those that are doing fitness and trying to get their body in shape, and that's good. And we need to be a healthy body. It needs to be a body that can be used to glorify God. But we're overly concerned. And fashions. We've got to have the latest fashions and we want to impress somebody. And we're all about passionate about having fun. And it's good to laugh. And I'm sure Jesus and his disciples had times of laughter, but there's times of seriousness too. But then we're also, it's that time of year, friends, it's football time in Tennessee and ATSU, and we're passionate about football, aren't we? And we'll get passionate about these things and forget about the things of God. When it comes to serving the Lord, being involved in ministry, taking up our cross and daily following Jesus, we don't seem to have that much passion. We would rather do things our way, in our time. We would rather find time for all kinds of earthly activities and put the things of God second in our life. You know, I recently had a conversation with a fellow believer. And one of their comments was, I'm saddened at what is happening to the church in America. All of us as Christians should be saddened by the immorality and complacency that we see permeating the church. But as I thought about that statement the person made, the Holy Spirit said to me, there is nothing wrong with the church. The problem is this, the Christians who make up the church. In regards to the church, Jesus said in Matthew chapter 16, verse 18, I will build my church and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. But I personally believe that the church will be here until Jesus takes us back to glory. And that being said, I believe the church has lost its effectiveness, its saltiness, and we should be saddened at what is happening with Christians. Now, here are a few reasons that we should be concerned with the present state of Christians in the church. Many Christians in the church have become worldly. They love the things of the world more than the things of God, and it shows in their priority and commitment. Many Christians in the church have itching ears and want to feel good, the feel-good messages instead of the truth that can change lives and grow stronger disciples. Many Christians don't see the need to be a part of church attendance where there is fellowship and discipleship, and they don't want to be a part of worship. Many Christians have an easy believism mentality. They think that once you put your trust in Jesus, there's you don't have to serve Him anymore, and you don't have to grow in your walk with the Lord, and you can just live any way that you want to because you have fire insurance to get you into heaven. Many Christians see prayer and Bible study as unnecessary in becoming more like Jesus. Many Christians do not understand the concept of taking up their cross and following Jesus daily. Many Christians do not understand what it means to present your body as a living sacrifice to God on a daily basis. Many Christians do not understand ministry and do not serve in the local church. Many Christians have no clue about humility and that by humbling yourself, you become more like Christ and you become a more effective person in church and society. Many Christians do not believe that we should become a volunteer slave to others instead of wanting to be served. Many have no understanding of what Jesus meant when He said, "The first shall be last and the last shall be first." For the body of Christ to be vibrant, strong, and effective once again, those of us in the body need to have a checkup. We need the great physician to examine us and convict us of the things that we need to change. We need to deal with our pride. Once that happens, we will no longer hear statements that people are concerned about the condition of the church in America, but our hearts will be burdened and we will weep like Jesus did when He looked out over Jerusalem at the condition of lost souls in America. Yes, we see the example of a human emotion, but we see the example of a holy emotion. Here Jesus is praying, "It's not about how I feel." I can tell you this, that in His humanity, in the way that I would feel in that situation, I would be looking for a way out of that cross. I would be looking for a way out of that. But He said, "It's not about the way I feel. It's about what needs to be done. It's about what God wants. It's not about what I want. It's about what the Heavenly Father wants in our life and in our church." Jesus had all the human emotions we have. He had fear and uncertainty, rejection, disappointment, and suffering. He was misunderstood. He was rejected. He was talked about. And the list goes on and on and on. But He laid everything aside to go to that cross for us. In Philippians chapter 2, verses 8 and 9, it says, "Being found in fashion as a man, He humbled Himself, and He became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. Wherefore God has highly exalted Him and given Him a name which is above every name." You know, others in the Bible have had to deal with their human emotions of fear and doubt, uncertainty, unworthiness, envy, disappointment, failure, and rejection. Moses, he said, "I stutter, Lord. I can't speak. You don't know, Lord. I can't stand before these people. I'm great in a moment of passion when I can kill the enemy, but I can't stand before the Pharaoh." He said, "I'll give you a mouthpiece. I'll take care of that for you. Just don't worry about it." Philip could not understand why he was in a great revival and then he was supposed to walk down to Gaza. Well, there was an Ethiopian who needed to hear the word of God. That's why. Jonah did not like the people of Nineveh, but he was told to go there. Noah was thought to be crazy when he was asked to build an ark. Ananias in Acts chapter 9 could not understand why he had to accept Saul of Tarsus, who had been persecuting the church. But God had a reason. Peter had blown it when he denied the Lord. He'd blown it, and he did not understand why he was to go to Cornelius. Paul thought that he was the worst sinner who ever lived, and his emotions and his feelings could have hindered him from being the servant, the great servant of God that he was. He could have said, "God, I can't do it. I'm so embarrassed to stand before them after I persecuted them, after I cursed you, and I did all these things. I just can't do it." He said, "I'm going to show my grace in you in a way that people are going to be amazed." All of these individuals learn the lesson that if we want success, it comes in doing His will and not our own. It's not how I feel. It's not what others think. It's about doing His will. It's not about us. It's all about Him. In John chapter 5, verse 30, the Bible says, "I can of mine own self do nothing. As I hear, I judge, and my judgment is just, because I seek not mine own will, but the will of the Father who has sent me." John chapter 8, verse 28 says, "Then said Jesus to them, 'When you have lifted up the Son of Man, then shall you know that I am He, and that I do nothing of myself, but as my Father has taught, I speak these things. In John 14, verse 10, he said, "Believest thou not that I am in the Father and the Father in me? The words that I speak unto you, I speak not of myself, but the Father that dwelleth in me, he doeth the works." If the Son of God had to pray these and said these things, then surely he's showing us that we can break down our passions and do his will. The last thing I want you to notice with me is that we need to ask him to subdue my energy. Subdue my energy. We can deal with our pride. We can deal with our passion. But we also need to deal with our plans. Notice the words, "Thine be done." This deals with our plans. And I want you to notice, first of all, the example of a humbled energy. It is clear in the Bible that great men and women were never used of God until they were broken. We need to fall upon our face in brokenness and confession, declaring that we can do nothing in and of ourselves. Like a wild Mustang is broken to harness the power of that horse, we need to be broken. Our plans need to be broken and become his plans. How many of you have ever watched the movie Hoosiers? Have you seen the movie The Hoosiers? Now, if you love basketball as I do, and if you've been a part of teams, you would love that movie. But let me just give you a little understanding. If you get a chance, watch the movie, because there's some great things. But the movie is about the Hickory Huskers. It was actually about Milan, a team in Indiana, but they used the Hickory Huskers as kind of changed the name. But it was about the 1954 Indiana High School Championship. Milan defeated Muncie. It's the story that was set between 1951 and 52, when all high schools in Indiana, regardless of their size, competed in one state championship. Now, Milan only had about 64 students. They only had about six on the team. And we find that Muncie was one of the biggest schools there in Indianapolis and a large school, but they beat them in the final seconds and won the championship for the state championship. Gene Hackman starred in the movie. And Dennis Hopper was in the movie. But Gene Hackman was Coach Norman Dale. He knew how to coach, and but he had been kicked out of coaching in college because he was suspended because he had hit one of his players. He had a volatile temper. He did have that, but he knew basketball. And his friend helped him get the job at Hickory High School. He was a disciplinarian. He knew how to break a team down and build it back up and get the most from his players. He believed in four passes before shooting, and he believed in a strict man-to-man defense. Here's some quotes that he said in the movie. They asked him about the team. He said, "There's lots of talent. It's raw and undisciplined. I'm going to break them down, and I'm going to build them up." When it was coming time to practice, they all wanted to practice. They all want to shoot. And they asked him, "When are you going to practice?" "We're not. We're not." It's all about drills. Until he got into the time that really needed to practice. But he was telling them about practice one day. He said, "My practices aren't designed for your enjoyment." Five players on the floor functioning as a single unit. Team, team, team was what he preached. No one more important than the other. At the end, they asked him about his team. And they didn't have really a winning record. That great of a record, but they did get to go to the championship because they got very on fire toward the end. But he said, "I apologize for nothing. I was hired to teach the boys the game of basketball, and I did it to the best of my abilities. You may not be pleased with the results, but I am." Well, when he first meets the team, he had them standing there, and there was Jimmy, who was a great shooter, but he wasn't going to play because he got upset the year before. So he was just going to quit. But he was looking and he was watching. And he knew they was getting a coach, and he kind of observed some things. At one point when they were going to get rid of the coach, Jimmy said, "He goes, I don't play. But he stays, I play." He was that missing piece to their offense. But when he first meets the team, two of them are talking and not paying attention. He said, "You're off the team." He told both of them, "Get out of here. If you can't respect the coach enough, we don't need you." And then one of them said, "When do we scrimmage? When do we shoot?" He said, "We don't." And they lined up the chairs and they started doing drills. They said, "This ain't no fun." And he said, "My practices aren't designed for your pleasure." There was a purpose there. He was breaking the team down. with drills that would get them to do the plays that he wanted. He would preach four passes. And in a game, one of the boys shot before four passes. He didn't do it one time, but he did it several times. He just didn't want to wait. He thought he was open and he would miss the shot. He was taken out of the game, sat on the bench. At halftime, he talked about it, but he told him, "You'll still be sitting on the bench." Well, they went out there. There was only six players that night. Five were on the floor, and one of them fouled out. The other one who had disobeyed the coach got up like he was going in. He said, "Where are you going?" He said, "Sit back down." He said, "But coach, we have to have five players." The ref came over and said, "Coach, need another player." He said, "My team is on the floor. My team is on the floor." Now, he lost the game that night playing four against five, but he taught a valuable lesson. Here's a lesson we need to learn in the church. Our team is here. Those that don't want to be a part of the team, those that don't want to be disobedient, they're not here. God has all that worked out. But we find that he went to one of the players' fathers. This was Wilbur Shooter Flatch. He was the only one that helped them get to a championship before. And he was a great player, knew basketball, but he had become an alcoholic. But he knew the game of basketball. He needed an assistant coach because the coach had had a heart attack, assistant coach. He needed someone with knowledge to sit on the floor with him and be there. And he went to visit him one night in his little shack, and he said, Wilbur starts out, he said, "Coach, thanks for coming by here. I apologize." And he had a warm fire, but he was some complimentaries, got them out of the way. He said, "I know everything there is to know about the greatest game ever invented. You're playing Cedar Knob tomorrow. Ain't nobody knows them any better than me. I've been watching how you've been breaking the coats, but my friend, you cannot play them all the way man to man tomorrow. They got no head toppers. Cedar Knob's a bunch of mites, run you off the boards. You got to squeeze back in the paint, make them chuck it from the cheap seats, watch that purgatory they call a gym, and no drive 12 foot in." Now that's basketball talk if you don't understand it, but if you know the game, you know what he's talking about. But the one thing I want you to see from that quote was, I've been watching how you've been breaking the coats. Sometimes we need to be broken. God needs to break us so that he can build us back up to the person that he wants us to be, and even the church that he wants us to be. You know, in my workplace, because I have been involved in team sports and playing ball, I have a quote that I have in my office. It says, "A team only exists when each player understands how their actions affect everyone else." Self has to be broken before God can work through us as individuals and a church. We have to become an empty vessel that he can fill. We have to keep emptying ourselves so that he can continually fill us up with more of him. Yes, we read about the story of Moses in Exodus chapter 3 and 4. God had to break him down to build him up. Jacob, in Genesis chapter 32, he wrestles with an angel because he had been a schemer, and his plans, he wanted to do it his way, but God gave him a limp to say, "You need to do it my way." Joseph, he's a great man in the Old Testament, kind of compared to Jesus in many of the ways. But in Genesis chapters 37 through 50, we find that he had to deal with something. How proud do you think that he was to go and show them that coat of many colors? He would tell his brothers, "God gave me a dream. He didn't give it to you, and here's what's going to happen." Well, God did give him the dream, but he was doing it in a boastful and a prideful way. "Look at the coat my father gave me. He didn't give you a coat." Well, they got mad and jealous. They put him into a pit, sold him into slavery, told their father he was dead. Joseph went and he was imprisoned. He went through many years of his life, but he became the second in command and saved his people. In Genesis chapter 50, verse 20, he said, "But as for you, you thought evil against me, but God meant it unto good to bring it to pass as it is this day to save much people alive." Sometimes we have to be broken to be greatly used of God. David said in Psalm 51, 17, "The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and a contrite heart. O God, thou wilt not despise." Peter denied the Lord, but when his passion was harnessed for Jesus, we see that he preached and over 5,000 were saved. Paul's passion was in destroying Christianity and the church, building religion. But when he was broken on the Damascus Road, he became one of the greatest witnesses the church has ever known. Jesus had to be completely broken in order to be our Savior. His prayer in the garden is his way of telling us that he was completely broken. We must remember the words of John 15, verse 5. Without me, you can do nothing. Zechariah chapter 4, verse 6 says, Then he answered and spake unto them, saying, This is the word of the Lord in Zerubbabel, saying, Not by my might, nor by my power, but by my spirit, saith the Lord of hosts. Lastly, I want you to see the example of a harnessed energy. You see, there are two examples in Scripture about subduing our energy. The first is a yoke, and the second is the cross. Let's look at the yoke first. It speaks of submission. Jesus said in Matthew chapter 11, verses 28 and 30, Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and ye shall find rest unto your souls, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Now, what is a yoke? Now, you won't see many of them today. They're still used, but not that greatly. But you'll go to a farm or an old place from days gone by, and you'll see. Basically, it is where an implement where has two heads in it, has a rod that goes through the middle and places for harnesses, but two oxen can go, their heads be put in there, and they're held there to work together. Two oxen can do more work than one, more efficiently and more effectively. And typically, one ox is more of a leader, and one ox is more of a follower. I want you to get the picture here. When we are yoked to Jesus and we accept that yoke, He is the leader and we are the follower and we will go where He is leading. Chris Tomlin has a song that says, Where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow you. Who you love, I'll love. How you serve, I'll serve. If this life I lose, I will follow you. I will follow you. Yes, there's the yoke, but then there's the picture of the cross. The cross speaks of sacrifice. In Luke chapter 9, verse 23, Jesus said to them, If any man will come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross daily, and follow me. We must put to death our selfish desires and our self-righteousness. In fact, the Living Bible quotes it this way, Anyone who wants to follow me must put aside his own desires and conveniences and carry his cross with him every day and keep close to me. When we ask the Lord to subdue me by praying, Not my will, but thine be done, we must be willing to put our head in the yoke, going wherever Jesus leads us to do. We must be willing to take up our cross, as Romans 12 verse 1 says, to lay it all on the altar and be a living sacrifice daily. That's what it means to subdue me, Lord. Have you prayed that prayer? If God has spoken to you this morning, as Monty comes and we'll sing a song of invitation, if you have prayed that prayer, or if God is speaking to you about some other decision, then I pray that you'll be obedient as we have a time of invitation this morning, as we stand and sing together.
Some call him Savior, the real.